Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Bishopsgate Institute. Welcome to everyone watching online via our Facebook live stream, and welcome to our audience here in the Great Hall as well. We've been putting on concerts here in the Great Hall since the 1940s, but only recently have we been able to reach new audiences by streaming our concerts online. The concerts are such an integral part of the Institute, and we invite the performers to explore the archives to take inspiration for their concerts. Today's concert takes inspiration from a portrait of Mary Howell, whose self-educated son became one of the most prominent and well-connected radicals of the 19th century. You can find out more information on today's concert and on the history of the Lunchtime concerts on the programme notes, which you'll find on the webpage. So, now please join me in welcoming Jenni Hogan and Alexander Rider for today's Lunchtime concert.
a red button. That says locked. It's on. Can you hear me? Hello? Why is it always like this? It's like some kind of bad dream, isn't it? I can't see you, but you can see me. Can you hear me all right? Yes, I beg your pardon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for being here today with this Luddite and Jenni. We've chosen a programme today, as you heard in the introduction, all by women composers, mostly from the 19th century, and one absolutely now at the cutting edge of music. The first piece you heard was by Cécile Chaminade, a French composer, woman composer. Now, Cécile began her career, she was born in the 1850s, she began her career as a sort of prodigious pianist, and I suppose you could say she composed kind of on the side, because her family absolutely forbade her to study composition. But she wrote anyway, and I suppose her most well-known piece is her concertino for the flute. But, you know, we've done some research, and some of the reviews we read at the time was along the lines of nice music for a girl kind of thing. So she had to work against that throughout her life. She had a very long life. She died in the 1940s, in her 90s. But one of her sort of, I suppose you could say, legacies was she was very popular in the United States, and her popularity as a performer started a kind of a vogue for women-only music clubs, which was a great place for women to come together in safety and enjoy music together, and including music written by people like Cécile Chaminade. So that was her, what's it called? Something de Étoile. Serenade. I always want to call it lullaby, but anyway, it's like a lullaby. Anyway, the next two pieces that we're going to play are by Florence Price, an American composer. And she's only sort of finding, I don't want to say popularity, but people are getting really interested in Florence Price. She was born at the turn of the last century in Little Rock, Arkansas. And she studied the piano and the organ and became a very well-known performer. She was also writing a lot of music. Then, like a lot of black musicians of her generation, where she was living, the racial tension and the racism became quite untenable. So Chicago in Illinois became a sort of mecca for these musicians. And I think it was only quite recently that someone clearing out a house in Chicago found all these boxes of documents and music of hers, of Florence Price. And it's sort of only coming to light. I'm going to plug someone else. If you're really interested in learning about Florence Price, you should check out the work of Dr. Samantha Egger, E-G-E, because she's doing loads on Florence Price and people like Margaret Bonds, and it's really very interesting. So we're going to play a piece called Silk Hat and Walking Cane, and that's kind of, it's not quite anything really, it's like a remembrance. It's a very tender kind of nod to ragtime and jazz and other genres, and it's really a lot of fun. And then we're going to play I always want to insert other titles. The Hidden Garden, The Deserted Garden, which is kind of also a kind of homage to kind of spirituals and kind of gospel piano. And they both work really well on flute and harp. So these are two pieces by Florence Price.
have to faff about for one moment. Next piece. This next piece, my good friend Ellen Sargent wrote for me. We decided to begin a collaboration just before the first lockdown last year, not knowing what was about to happen. And so in order to sort of artificially manufacture the kind of close relationship that you often get when you collaborate with another musician, we started, and also as a sort of therapy thing, we started sending one another these videos Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, only about a minute long. In fact, I think the rule was it could only be a minute long, just sort of like a diary of how our days had been, sort of confessional thing. And sometimes they'd be done in bed last thing at night, sometimes they'd be done on our government mandated walk. Sometimes I'd do them when I was looking after my little girl, and sometimes all sorts of things. And they became a really helpful crutch for us both, getting us through difficult days and feeling good about happier days. And so she took these videos, and there were lots of them. There was 4 or 5 months of worth of them in the end. And she put them all together and found the bits that were most important to her, and sort of constructed this flute part around the tape part that she made out of these videos. And I think the thing she really wanted to explore was the feeling of struggling and struggling and struggling, but ultimately being able to breathe less no matter how much she struggled, and being able to speak less no matter how much she struggled. And that was kind of her experience of that first lockdown. I was meant to play this piece a year ago, but then the second lockdown happened, so I didn't. It's been a bit of an interesting experience hearing these our voices again, and the bird song again, and the wind. You can hear a lot of wind in the mobile phone microphone. Yeah, hope you enjoy it.
Hiya, so it's Monday, I think it's the 28th of March, so I got up, I drank a lot of tea, I ate some muesli, I played some drums with my mum, flute and piano drums. So my main event of this morning is a big one, because I was allowed to go outside today. Hello! For one reason or another, today has not gone the way I kind of hoped or expected it would. I've had a really miserable couple of days. I think the monotony of everything has really sunk in, and we were doing all these like crazy things, like getting up at 5:30 in the morning and going for a run and stuff. We did that for about 3 weeks, and I'm just really exhausted. Hi, so really, really good day today. We had breakfast all together, and then I did a bit of recording, which was cool. It's nice to do something like that right at the beginning of the day.
For a bit, which is not a knack, I'm just hoping you're okay.
I think I was ludicrously anxious about it, but didn't really realise.
Okay,
start my day with a really nice phone call with especially your local mom.
And reading group.
From there, I didn't really get on too well. Quite distracted today by the news and I don't know things. But I've just been on a really lovely walk. Found a different walk. All along by the canal. There's still quite a lot of people around. But yeah, it was nice. The sun came out.
Let me know how you're doing. I'd really love to know.
I feel a little bit better.
I'm going to be better at this because I actually really miss doing it and I find it really helpful.
I think I'm now going to try and do some kind of exercise in the flat.
I was a bit despairing because it's all like the city and...
Yeah, and then have dinner and then that's another day, isn't it?
Can I get back into video starting now? It's hugely nice to restart this. Okay, hope you're okay. Bye.
Friend. I'm going to play two pieces for you now for solo harp by a French composer again called Henriette Regnier. She's a person that she has a very dear place in my heart, and I think she does for a lot of harpists. Her music still remains very popular among harpists. Not these two pieces so much, they're a bit of a rarity, so I'm very happy to be playing them for you. Regnier was from a very good French middle class family. And her parents were the what we might call today as a little bit arty. But that was about as far as it went. So when she developed as a harpist, she learned to play the harp and became a student at the Paris Conservatoire, I think when she was 7 or 8. Her family kind of watched from the sidelines, and then she got her first prize when she was only 11. Now, in those days, when you were at the Paris Conservatoire, you didn't do an exam, you did something called a concours, a competition. So for the musicians in the room, if you can imagine doing your final exam and having your sight reading picked over by the press, that gives you a bit of an idea of what it was like. It was pretty fearsome. And the other thing is that once you had your first prize, you were cooked, you were done, you could go out and do what you like with that, goodbye. And she was only 11. So she thought, I'd quite like to do other things to do with music, so she became the only woman to enroll in the composition class. So she composed throughout her lifetime. She was also a very gifted teacher. People went from all over the world to study with her. And she used to teach in the summer in a place called Etretat in Normandy, the subject of a famous painting by Monet, the cliffs at Etretat. And she had a house right on the seafront near the cliffs, and these two pieces are about her morning walks in Etretat. So the first piece she describes coming out of her front garden and seeing the kind of the calm sea horizon. And then the second piece sort of describes the kind of the sparkling dew, catching the morning sunlight. So here are two promenades by Henriette Regnier. For our last pair of pieces, we're going to play two pieces by Lily Boulanger. Lily was from a very musical family. Her elder sister, Nadia, was really well known as a mentor and teacher to all kinds of musicians and composers, including Stravinsky and Piazzolla, Thea Musgrave, who was recently on BBC Desert Island Discs talking about learning from Nadia. Anyway, Nadia had been a composer, but when her sister Lily, whose music we're going to play, died of intestinal tuberculosis at the age of 24, she felt it was really her life's work to keep the memory of her sister and her sister's music alive. Lily had been the only woman ever to win the Prix de Rome, the Rome Prize, which is, if you wanted to be anyone as a composer in France last century, you had to get your prize in Rome. And she gained a brilliant first prize there with her cantata, Faust and Helen. She had these underlying health problems, and that last bit of exertion really sort of finished her off in a way. Funnily enough, she was in this kind of circle of female musicians that Regnier was part of as well. They were well known to each other. Lily did also play the harp. And although these pieces weren't written for the harp and flute originally, they're actually violin and piano pieces, I feel like there's this kind of, the image of the harp kind of ghosted or occulted kind of appears throughout it. Even the way it looks on the page, it looks really harpy. And we think they work really nicely. And we know you're going to agree. So these are two pieces by Lily Boulanger to finish off. Thank you so much for being a wonderful audience and putting up with me and the mic. And so we're going to play Nocturne and Cortège by Lily Boulanger. Thank you.
Jenni Hogan and Alexander Rider. Thank you for joining us, both in the room and online. Please join us next week for 30 Swing from Basin Street Brawlers, or any new music fans out there, look out for Heather Roche the week after. Finally, these concerts are free for you to attend, but they're not free to put on, so please consider donating either online, bishopsgate.org.uk, or by waving your card on the way out there. Thank you once more to Jenni Hogan and Alexander Rider.